Dr. Carmen Quarter here with ACLS Certification Association, and today's lesson is on
neurogenic versus spinal shock.
Don't forget to visit us online at aclscertification.org to certify or recertify your ACLS, PALS, BLS, or NRP 100% online. Now let's get started.
So let's start talking about these two different types of shock. We have neurogenic shock and spinal shock, both occurring in patients who have undergone or suffered a spinal cord injury. Sometimes students will get these confused, but they are very, very different disorders. A real simple memory trick to help you: with neurogenic shock, the nervous system is in shock. Neurogenic, the entire nervous system. With spinal shock, it's just the spinal cord, the tasks that the spinal cord is supposed to accomplish. So with neurogenic shock, the nervous system is in shock. Spinal shock, it's just the spinal cord. With neurogenic shock, typically the spinal cord injury is a very high level injury, usually above the level of T6. That's kind of our magic number, right? That places spinal cord injury patients at risk for complications. So you have a very acute, high-level spinal cord injury, and what happens as the spinal cord is the information highway, if you will, relaying messages and input from the periphery to the brain and then sending a response from the brain back out to the muscles and the tissues in the periphery. With this neurogenic shock, there is a disruption of the sympathetic nervous system messages that are being relayed from the levels of T1 all the way down to L2. So there's basically just a loss of sympathetic nervous system stimulation with neurogenic shock. So with loss of sympathetic nervous system stimulation, or the SNS, you lose those fight or flight hormones, and those are epinephrine and norepinephrine. Those are also going to be referred to as catecholamines, so you might see them referred to that way on your exams, but the end result is loss of the effects of epinephrine and norepinephrine, and they are very powerful vasoconstrictors. They have positive chronotropic effects, meaning they increase the heart rate. So if you lose epinephrine and norepinephrine, you're going to see the very opposite. So the patient will experience bradycardia, very significant bradycardia due to the loss of epinephrine, and very, very significant hypotension because of vasodilation that results due to the loss of norepinephrine. Those are the two big signs and symptoms of neurogenic shock. With neurogenic shock, obviously, with all spinal cord patients, your priority is your ABCs, maintaining the airway and breathing. Cervical spine precautions needs to be thrown in there also as necessary, but you're going to be focusing very, very heavily on maintaining that blood pressure because these patients are going to be undergoing massive vasodilation and bradycardia. So you'll treat the bradycardia with atropine. You'll treat the hypotension with fluids. You want to keep that MAP usually greater than about 80 or 85 in spinal cord injury patients. That's just a real quick overview of neurogenic shock. So now let's compare that with spinal shock. And remember, spinal shock is just simply the spinal cord is in shock. So you have a spinal cord injury. It doesn't have to be a high level injury. It can occur anywhere along the spinal cord. And with that spinal cord injury, as with any traumatic injury, there's bleeding and inflammation that occurs at the site of injury. Now, what that does is that causes tissue damage in that area, and that damaged tissue releases chemical mediators. And those chemical mediators, in this case, happen to cause very potent vasoconstriction. So what that results in, between the tissue damage, the inflammation, and the vasoconstriction, it results in spinal cord ischemia. And ischemia, we know, is no blood flow. So spinal cord ischemia and hypoxia. So a spinal cord that is not receiving blood flow, that is not oxygenated, is not going to do its job properly. So what it results in is paralysis, loss of sensation below the level of the injury. Depending on the type of spinal cord injury and the significance, was it a complete transection of the spinal cord? Was it just a partial? The patient may regain movement. They may regain sensation. But again, that totally depends on the significance of the injury. With a complete spinal cord transection, meaning that the spinal cord is transected, then no, the patient will unfortunately not regain movement and sensation below the level of the injury. Sometimes it's just a matter of compression. And once that inflammation and bleeding is relieved and the pressure is relieved off of that area, then that's when the patient will regain feeling, movement, sensation below the level of that injury.
That's it for our lesson today. Thanks for watching, and remember to check out our website at aclscertification.org for more free content or to get certified or recertified online.